Erdogan and the United States regime and the Western regimes in general are going to stop, and of course Saudi Arabia and Qatar are going to stop the support of the terrorists. I don't see it in the next 2 months.
I'll start by talking about the ceasefire in Syria. Russia, the US, and several countries say a ceasefire could be revived despite the recent violence and recrimination. Do you agree, and are you prepared to try again?
We announced that we are ready to be committed to any halt of operation, or if you want to call it ceasefire. But it's not about Syria or Russia. It's about the United States and the terrorist group that's been affiliated to ISIS and al-Nusra and al-Qaeda, and to the United States and to Turkey and Saudi Arabia. They announced publicly that they're not committed. And this is not the first attempt to have a halt of operation in Syria. The first attempt was in last February, and didn't work, I think, because the United States, and I believe that the United States is not genuine regarding having cessation of violence in Syria.
Do you believe there could ever be a joint US-Russian military partnership against the militants, as outlined in the deal?
Again, practically yes, but in reality no, because the United States doesn't have the will to work against al-Nusra or even ISIS, because they believe that this is a card they can use for their own agenda. And if they attack al-Nusra or ISIS, they will lose a very important card regarding the situation in Syria. So I don't believe the United States will be ready to join Russia in fighting terrorists in Syria.
This week, the US has said the coalition attack on Syrian troops was an accident. Do you accept their explanation?
No, it's not, because it wasn't an accident by one airplane once, let's say. It was four airplanes that kept attacking the position of the Syrian troops for nearly 1 hour, or a little bit more than 1 hour. You don't commit a mistake for more than 1 hour. This first, second, you're not attacking, they weren't attacking a building in a quartier. They were attacking a huge place constituted of many hills, and there was no terrorist adjacent to the Syrian troops there. At the same time, the ISIS troops or the ISIS militants attacked right away after the American strike. How could they know that the Americans are going to attack that position in order to gather the militants to attack right away and to capture it 1 hour after the strike? So it was definitely intentional, not unintentional, as they claimed.
Did Syria or Russia launch the attack on the Red Crescent convoy this week? And should Moscow be held responsible, as the White House has said?
No, first of all, they've been tens maybe of convoys from different organizations around the world coming to different areas in Syria for the last few years. It has never happened before, so why to happen now, either by the Russians or the Syrians? No, it's a claim. And regarding the claim of the White House yesterday, accusing either the Syrian or the Russian in that regard, I would say whatever the American officials said about the conflicts in Syria in general has no credibility. Whatever they say, it just lies and bubbles, has no foundation on the ground.
So what happened to the convoy? Who should be held responsible?
Those convoys were in the area of the militants, were in the area under the control of the terrorists. That's what they should accuse first. The people or the militant, the terrorists who are responsible of the security of this convoy. So we don't have any idea about what happened. The only thing that we saw was a video of burned car, destroyed trucks, nothing else.
Several eyewitnesses have told AP that 20 missiles were launched against the convoy. There is footage of torn bodies. This does not seem as though it would be anything but an attack from the air. Yeah. Eyewitnesses are also talking about barrel bombs, and as you are aware, your administration has been accused of using barrel bombs in such circumstances. Do you still think this was an attack from the ground by rebels?
Yeah, so first of all, even the United Nations said that there was no airstrikes against that convoy. That was yesterday. Second, at the same time of that event, the terrorists were attacking the Syrian troops by missile. They launched missile attacks. We didn't. So we didn't respond. Third, you cannot talk about eyewitness for such a judgment or accusation. What are the credibility of those eyewitnesses? Who are they? We don't know.
We have eyewitnesses that were relatives. We have the white helmets. We have many people saying that they witnessed helicopters in the air. Now, only the Syrians and the Russians have helicopters.
Yeah, but those,
are you saying this is just
those witnesses,
invented?
Those witnesses only appear when there's accusation against the Syrian army or the Russian. But when the terrorists commit crime or massacre or anything, you don't see any witness, any witnesses, and you don't hear about those white helmets. So what a coincidence. Now, actually, we don't have any interest in doing so for one reason, because if we attack any convoy that's going to the civilians, we are working for the interest of the terrorists. That will play into their hands directly. In that regard, we are pushing the civilians toward the terrorists. We put them in their labs, and we are providing the terrorists with the good incubator. Something we didn't do. This is first. Second, we are, as government, as official, we are committed morally toward the Syrian people, morally, constitutionally, and legally, to help them in every aspect to have the basic need for their livelihood.
Your administration has denied the use of chemical weapons, of barrel bombs, despite testimony and video and the results of a UN investigation. We also are hearing similar denials about airstrikes on civilians and medical workers. Can this all be false allegations by your opponents?
Yeah, first of all, the first incident of gas used in Syria was in Aleppo about more than 3 years ago. And we were the ones who invited the United Nations to send delegation for investigations about the use of chemical weapons. And the United States objected and opposed that action. For one reason, because if there's investigations, they're going to discover that the terrorists use gas, not the Syrian army. In that regard, in that case, the United States won't be able to accuse Syria. That's why they were opposing that delegation. In every incident, we ask the United Nations to send delegation, and we are still insisting on that position that they have to send delegation to make investigation, but the United States is opposed. So actually, if we've been using that, we wouldn't ask for investigation.
To the international community, it seems as though none of the charges or accusations stick, that everything is denied, everything here is okay.
By
your administration.
Yeah.
Do you not feel that that undermines the credibility? In other instances, the Americans, for example, admitted the attack on the Syrian military was a mistake. Now, you don't accept that, but from the Syrian administration, all the international community hears is denial.
Regarding which issue?
Regarding the accusations of violations of human rights, of barrel bombs.
Okay. Look, if we want to talk about the mistakes, every country has mistakes, every government has mistakes, every person has mistakes. When you have war, you have more mistakes. That's the natural thing. But the accusation have no foundation regarding Syria. When they talk about barrel bombs, what a barrel bomb is? It's just a title they use in order to show something which is very evil, that could kill people indiscriminately. And as I say, because in the media, when it bleeds, it leads. They don't talk about bombs. No, they call it barrel bombs. Bomb is a bomb. What's the difference between different kinds of bombs? All bombs are to kill, but it's about how to use it. When you use armament, you use it to defend the civilians. You kill terrorists in order to defend civilians. That's the natural role of any army in the world. When you have terrorists, you don't throw them with the balloons, or you don't use rubber sticks, for example. You have to use the armaments. So it's not about what the kind of armament, is about how to use it. And they want to use it to accuse, use that term to accuse the Syrian army of killing civilians. We don't kill civilians because we don't have the moral incentive. We don't have the interest to kill civilians. Our people, who support us? If we want to kill the Syrian people, who's going to support us as government, as officials? No one. So in reality, you cannot withstand for 5 years and more against all those countries, the West and the Gulf state, the petrodollars, and all this propaganda, the strongest media corporation around the world, if you don't have the support of the of your own people. That's, again, the reality. So no, we don't use it. I wouldn't say that we don't have mistakes again, that many mistakes that have been committed by individuals, but there's difference between a mistake or even a crime that's been committed by individual and between a policy of crime that's been implemented or adopted by government. We don't have such a policy.
And yet the hundreds of thousands of Syrians who are fleeing the country, many drowning on the way, many of them say they are fleeing your forces. What exactly are they fleeing if this campaign doesn't exist, if this campaign of violence indiscriminate against them?
You have to look at the reality in Syria. Whenever we liberate any city or village from the terrorists, the civilians will go back to the city. While they flee that city when the terrorists attack that area, not the opposite. So they flee, first of all, the war itself. They flee the area under the control of the terrorists. They flee the difficult situation because of the embargo by the West on Syria. So many people, they flee not the war itself, but the consequences of the war, because they want to leave. They want to have the basic needs for their livelihood. They don't have it. They have to flee these circumstances, not necessarily the security situation itself. So you have different reasons for the people or the refugees to leave Syria. Many, many of them supported the government in the recent presidential elections in different countries. So that's not true that they left Syria because of the government. And that accusations mean that the government is killing the people while the terrorists, mainly Al-Qaeda and Al-Nusra and the other Al-Qaeda-affiliated organizations or groups, protected the civilian. Is that the accusation? No one can believe it, actually.
Let's turn our attention to the people that can't flee, the people who are in besieged cities around Syria, for example, Aleppo.
Yeah.
To go back to the ceasefire agreement, aid was supposed to get into the city, but you did not hold up your end of the agreement. Why was that, and how can you really justify withholding aid to cities?
Again, if we talk about the last few years, many aids coming to different cities. So why do the Syrian government prevent convoy from coming to Aleppo, for example, while allowing the others to reach other areas? This is contradiction. This is not, you cannot explain it. It's not palatable. This first. Second, if you look at the other area under the control of the terrorists, we're still sending vaccines from the Syrian government budget. We're still sending salaries to the employees from the Syrian government budget. So how can we do this and at the same time push the people towards starvation in other areas? More importantly, the terrorists who left liberated areas under the what you call reconciliation or certain agreements in different areas, they left to fight with other terrorists in Syria while they send their families to live under the supervision of the government. Why didn't we put those families to starvation? So this is contradicting. I mean, what you're talking about is contradicting the reality, and we don't contradict ourselves.
But the world saw the reality of Aleppo. There were UN convoys of aid that were not allowed into the city. Are you denying that that was the case?
The situation has been like this for years now. If there is really besiege or siege around the city of Aleppo, people would have been dead by now. This is first. Second, more importantly, they've been shelling the neighboring areas and the position of the Syrian army for years, non-stop shelling of mortars and different kind of lethal bombs. How could they be starving while at the same time they can have armaments? How can we prevent the foods and the medical aid from reaching that area and we cannot stop the armament from reaching that area, which is not logical.
So what is your message to the people of Aleppo who are saying the opposite, that they are hungry, that they are suffering malnutrition, that there are no doctors, that doctors have been targeted and killed in airstrikes, that they are under siege and they are dying? What is your message to them?
You can't say the people of Aleppo, because the majority of the people of Aleppo live in the area under the control of the government. So we cannot talk about the people of Aleppo. If you want to talk about some who allegedly claiming this, would tell them, how could you still be alive? Why don't you have, for example, epidemic if you don't have doctors? How could you say that we attacked, they accused Syria of attacking hospitals? So you have hospitals and you have doctors and you have everything. How could you have them? How could you have armament? That's the question. How can you get armament to your people if you claim that you have people and grassroots while you don't have food? They have to explain. I don't have to explain. The reality is telling.
Yeah, they say the opposite. They say they are surviving on whatever they can, on meager means.
Again.
And they are a city under siege. You do not accept that Aleppo is a city under siege with people starving and hungry.
Again, how can I prevent the food, not prevent the armament? Logically, how? If I can prevent food, I should be able to prevent armaments. If I don't prevent armament, then means everything else will pass to Aleppo.
Have you been to Aleppo recently? Will you go to Aleppo? And how does it feel for you to see the devastation in parts of what was known as the jewel of Syria?
Devastation is painful, of course, but we can rebuild our country. We're going to do that. Someday the war will stop. The most painful is the devastation of the society, the killing, the blood shedding, something we live with every hour and every day. But how would I think? I would think when I see those pictures, how would Western official feel when they look at these devastation and these killing pictures and they know that their hands are stained with their blood, that they are committed the crime directly in killing those people and destroying our civilization? That's what I think about.
Yet to the outside world, it feels as though the end justifies any means in your war on terror. Do you accept that?
They don't have morals, of course. This is Machiavellian principle. The end justifies the means. We don't accept it, no. Your policy should be a mixture between your interests and how you reach your means, but based on values. It cannot be only end justify the means, because for the criminals, ends justify the means. For thieves, for every illegal and immoral action, end justify the means. That's exactly what you mentioned in your question. This is the basement, the foundation of the Western policy around the world these days.
And what is your message to the Syrians who have fled the country? Some of them didn't make it, others did.
Yeah.
Do you call on them to come back? Do you expect them to come back?
Of course, it's a loss. It's a great loss. The worst loss any country has, not the infrastructure or the building or the material loss. Actually, it's the human resources loss. Something you want to see coming back to Syria. And I'm sure that the majority of those Syrians who left Syria, they will go back when the security, when the life going back to its normality, when the minimum requirements for livelihood will be affordable to them, they will go back. I'm not worried about this.
Do you have any expectation of when that will happen? When Syria will be pacified to some degree that they can come back?
Yeah, if we look at it from according to the internal Syrian factors, I would say it's very, very soon, few months, and I'm sure about that, I'm not exaggerating. But when you talk about it as part of a global conflict and regional conflict, when you have many external factors that you don't control, it's going to drag on, and no one in this world can tell you when, but the countries, the government, the officials who support directly the terrorists, only they know, because they know when they're going to stop supporting those terrorists. And this is where the situation in Syria is going to be solved without any real obstacles.
So let's just dwell on that point for a moment. Do you believe that in a couple of months, the situation in Syria will have dramatically changed in your favor to the point that refugees can come back?
No, because I don't believe that in a couple of months Erdogan and the United States regime and the Western regimes in general are going to stop. And of course, Saudi Arabia and Qatar are going to stop the support of the terrorists. I don't see it in the next 2 months.
So how can you really incite Syrians to come back in 2 months, as you said?
I said if there's no external factors. I said if you look at it as isolated case, as a Syrian case, which is theoretical, I mean, this is where you can say in a few months you can solve it. But now we're talking about a situation which is part, as a, you're talking about arena which is part of the international and regional arena, not isolated. So this is where you can, like I said, no one have the answer, when will it end?
It's now 1 year since Russia got involved in the war.
Yeah.
Before the intervention, you were losing territory and control. Did you ever feel like you were losing the war?
We didn't look at it that way, to lose the war, because whenever you have Syrians working with the terrorists, it's a loss. How to lose the war, this is a hypothetical question, to be frank. It's not about your feeling, it's about the reality. In the war, you lose areas, but you recapture another area. So it's difficult to tell whether you are losing or gaining, or it was a standstill. No one had this answer. But definitely after the Russian intervention in supporting the Syrian army, legally of course, we felt much, much better. We captured many main cities, many more main positions at the expense of the terrorist areas.
Even if you were to win the war, what would be left of your country and Syrian society? Will you have to think again about the prospect of a partitioned Syria?
No, we never thought about it, and the majority in Syria don't believe in this. And I don't think the reality, in spite of this savage war, has created the atmosphere for such partition. Actually, in many areas, the social situation is much better, because when you want to talk about partition, you need to find these borders between the social communities. You cannot have partition only on political basis or geographic basis. It should be social, first of all, when the communities don't live with each other. As a result of the war, many Syrians understand that the only way to protect your country is to live with each other with integration, not only in coexistence, which actually more precisely is cohabitation, when people interact and integrate with each other on a daily basis in every detail. So I think in this regard, I'm more assured that Syria will be more unified. So the only problem now that we face, not the partition, terrorism.
And yet you're not seen as a unifying force in Syria. People think that the society is torn apart. Just to use one example, on a personal level, you trained as a doctor, and yet your administration stands accused of targeting medical and rescue workers as they race to save lives. How do you make peace with this? And is this a society that, after suffering such consequences, can really just forget the past and move on?
Yeah, I cannot answer that question while it's filled with misinformation. Let's correct it first. We don't attack any hospital. Again, as I said, this is against our interests. If you put aside the morals, that we don't do it morally, if I put it aside, I'm talking about now, let's say the ends justify the means. If I want to use it, we don't have any interest. This is how we can help the terrorists, if we attack hospitals, schools, things like this. Of course, whenever you have war, the civilians and the innocent will pay the price. That's in any war. Any war is a bad war, no good war. Any war, people will pay the price. But I'm talking about the policy of the government or the army. We don't attack any hospital. We don't have any interest in attacking hospital. So what the other part of the question, sorry, to remind me?
That's okay. That fits into the general question, but I'd like to follow up with, if others say the opposite, including medical workers, including the Syrian white helmets, if you value their work, racing to the scene of whatever it may be to try and save lives, does that mean you would support the recent nomination of the white helmets for a Nobel Peace Prize?
It's not about the white helmet, whether they are credible or not, because some organizations are politicized, but they use different humanitarian masks and umbrellas just to implement certain agendas. But generally, if you talk about the humanitarian support, how can I attack hospitals? hospitals while I'm sending vaccines, for example. Just explain it. You tell me two different things, two contradicting things. One that I'm talking about is the reality, because everybody knows that we are sending vaccines. The other one, that we are attacking hospitals. It doesn't, they don't match. They don't match.
Would you support them for a Nobel Peace Prize?
Who?
The White Helmets.
Well, what did they achieve in Syria? And how unpoliticized the Nobel Prize? That's the other question. So if I get answer to these two questions, I can answer you. But I would only give a prize to whoever worked for the peace in Syria, first of all by stopping the terrorists from flowing towards Syria only.
My last question, the US election is now just a few weeks away. How do you expect that a Clinton or Trump presidency would differ in terms of US policy towards Syria and specifically toward you?
The problem with every American candidates regarding the presidency, I'm not talking only about this campaign or elections, generally, that they say something during the campaign and they do the opposite after the campaign. As we see now, the American official, they say something in the morning and they do the opposite in the evening. So you cannot judge those people according to what they say. You cannot take them at their words, to be frank with you. We don't listen to their statement. We don't care about it. We don't believe it. We have to wait till they become presidents. We have to watch their policy and their actions and their behaviors. We don't have a lot of expectations. We never had. We have hopes that we can see a rational American president, fair, obey the international law, deal with other countries according to mutual respect, parity, and etc. But we all know that this is only wishful thinking and fantasy.
Thank you very much, President Assad.